tuning into the online broadcast network, AfterBuzz TV. Over 20 million weekly downloads in over 150 countries and your number one source for after-show entertainment. TV, the destination for TV superfans, producing aftershows for over 300 of your favorite TV shows, interviewing celebrities and showrunners, and bringing you behind-the-scenes exclusives. All thanks to E! Entertainment's Maria Menounos, producer Kevin Undergaro, and internet leader Akamai. Now, let the buzz begin!
Hello, AfterBuzz TV fans, and welcome to another episode of The Voice Of. I'm Katie Cullen, and I am here with the fantastically talented Liam O'Brien. How are you doing today?
Oh, hi. I'm okay. My feet are recovering from Comic-Con and then a day at Legoland to boot.
You added Legoland on top of Comic-Con?
Well, I have kids, so that's what we do. It's our... Oh, maybe I should just tell the world exactly what we do every Comic-Con as we go. And I tromp all over the gas lamp district and do the con thing, and then we go ride with the kids to the land of Lego.
So you're superhuman is what you're saying.
I'm a broke-down old mule who just pulls the cart one day at a time.
Well, I think you're faring a little better than I am at con recovery. Mm. So... let's talk about some of the fun stuff in your career. How did you get into the industry?
Well, I've been an actor for a long time. I started in high school in The King and I, which is my first ever production.
Really?
Yes. I played a slave and Sir Edward Ramsay, who was an English ambassador. And I'm sure I was terrible. But I did high school plays and just decided that was it. And I went to NYU and... plunked around theater school and then plunked around theater doing serious plays, and eventually I met a guy. I mean, that's a pretty common story for people doing this.
It's a lot of who you know.
Right. Well, yeah, you just, actors meet actors, and that's how everything works, really, but it's especially true for our business. And this guy had met a guy a couple of years before me, and so he just paid it forward, and... what started as sort of a thin little dribble of dubbing anime work in New York City before I moved west just slowly rolled down the hill, and now it's like this big old snowball going down.
And now you have an IMDb page that's 3 miles long.
Yes. I'm trying desperately to think of some sort of length joke for paper.
And, it'll come to you.
Yeah, it'll come
at the end of this episode. You'll come up with it as we're signing
off. So far, all the options are probably too crass, so I'm just going to leave them on the table.
We'll just wind up rated explicit on iTunes.
Oh, okay.
So if you could go back on stage, would you be interested in doing another theater production if you could?
Oh, heck yeah.
What would you like to do?
What would I like to do? I'd like to do some Shakespeare outside.
Shakespeare in the Park?
Mm-hmm. Which I've done a little bit. I did a Midsummer once like that, and it was.
Who did you play?
I played Puck, man. I played Puck, and I wore little sort of leaf-colored chonies and some sneakers because the grass was covered in goose poop, so I had to dodge goose poop. And I had leaves in my hair and glitter and all that. All that was great.
So it's a regular Saturday night at Comic-Con.
Yeah. It was a rave. I'd like to work, I've worked at the Geffen here in town.
Really?
Yeah, 8 years ago, last play that I did. So, there was a point in my career where I was doing plays still, even after I moved here, and I started directing other actors for dubs of anime, and I was starting to get voiceover work in games more than I had. And it was paying the bills and coming at me, and theater, film, TV, I was like chasing. And I had a kid, and that decided everything. So I told myself that I'd put it on pause, and we're almost 9 years later. And I'm finally at a point where I'm starting to sniff around town, seeing if someone will trust me to get back on the stage.
Well, let us know if you get a role. We would love to see it.
I will.
So it sounds like voice acting and directing all kind of happened at around the same time then.
Yeah, I came up through sort of the trapdoor in the business. Japanese animation, while scoffed at.
Not so much anymore, I don't think.
Well.
No?
you know, well, show me the money. Yeah. You know.
Point.
It's just the budgets are smaller.
True.
And but it's still the most difficult voiceover work I do when I do it. You know, it's highly technical.
What is it that makes it so difficult?
Well, you're when I work on a game or animation now, I've almost never have any kind of picture or anything. It's just the sky's the limit with your imagination. There's no timing constraints other than maybe the director will say, yeah, we need you to go a little faster, or I think this moment should slow down or something. They'll just, you know, you're feeling it out. But with dubbing anime, the picture, it's a finished show, so everything is locked. They're not going to reanimate mouths for English. And it's the same flap, we call it the flap. Flap, 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 flap. So they hire someone like me to look at a direct English translation. I don't speak Japanese, but I get English translated for each line and go, oh, that's way too long or way too short or it sounds ridiculous. Or there's the Japanese character is pausing constantly, but this is just like one long sentence. So you have to creatively find ways to shrink, shorten, slide thoughts around. It's like a little Rubik's Cube. And that's just the writing of it. And then an actor comes in, has never seen the show, usually, has no idea what the timing is, doesn't have the lines memorized or anything, and you just have to be able to, in the moment, read the line, you get a preview, and then you jump in, and you're both watching that flap, keeping an eye on the flap, while keeping an emotional life going at the same time. So it's just spinning a lot of plates at the same time. And it's just this weird little nook of the entertainment industry where almost like no one, the guards aren't watching the door. No, you know, the guy with the key is on a coffee break. And someone gave me a chance. No one would have given me a chance to, I don't know, to play Gollum right off the bat. But someone was willing to give me a chance to audition for an anime series. And so anime, for like 3 or 4 years, I was pecking away at that, doing a couple jobs a year, and then I got here, and there's not as much going on in LA, I think, as there used to be, but when I first got here, there was still plenty, and after a year of acting and stuff, somebody in town said, you know, you're not a total idiot, would you like to write a couple of these for me? And I said, oh, sure. He asked if I was a writer, and I lied and said I was, and then suddenly I was a writer. And then 6 months after that, he said, yeah, I was right. You are not a dope. How would you like to direct? And can you direct? And I lied again and said, yeah, sure, of course. And that.
So you just kind of hit the ground running on everything.
Hit the ground running. Yeah. You just step out there and trust that it's going to work. That has proved my motto in my career. And working in Japanese animation led to acting in Japanese games, which led to directing voiceover for Japanese games, Resident Evil 5, and I was like a joint director. There were Stephanie Shea is another great actor in our circle. She and I sort of tag teamed the voiceover, and there was a cinematics director. And then by the time I got to Resident Evil 6, they handed me the whole enchilada, and I was on the mocap set sort of as like a English acting guru for the two Japanese directors, and you know, I helped out, and then became the voiceover director once they finished filming the mocap scene. So it just like little by little, I kept getting trusted with more. Suddenly, I'm helping Neil Druckmann on The Last of Us, directing Orcs for Shadow of Mordor. So overnight success in like I don't know, 13 years ish.
That's a very long night.
Yeah, yeah.
So there are a number of projects where you've written and directed and voiced. Where does that overlap?
You mean I've had a hand in all of it?
Yeah.
I'm trying to think. Well, like, there haven't been that many with writing all three. But yeah, I mean, I've written series. There was an anime early on my time here in L.A. called Gunsword. Giant robots and other things.
As you do.
And I auditioned for a part for a show that I knew I was going to be writing and directing, and I booked one of those parts, a character called Ray, for anyone who's seen Gunsword. And then I started writing it with myself in mind, and then I started directing myself, and I was way more critical of myself than I was of other people, so I'd be a little OCD and probably redo things a little too much. But I've gotten a little more fast and loose in my old age. I haven't actually acted, written, and directed anything in a while. I've done a lot of acting directing, but not the whole trifecta.
that little Venn diagram doesn't overlap too terribly
not
often.
Not anymore, no.
All right. I have to ask, what's the favorite line that you've written for yourself or for anyone else? What are you particularly proud of?
Are you familiar with Bleach?
Yes.
The show Bleach, yeah. I adapted episodes of that at the beginning, only for like the first 15 or 20 episodes. But for anyone who knows Bleach, the characters are sort of spirit warriors. And that's very simplified explanation of what they are. But they all have a magic sword that's sort of part of their essence. And the main character, who's not even supposed to be there, has this gigantic, they're called Zanpakuto on the show. And he's meeting one of these other guys for the first time, and no one thinks he should be there, and he's got this sword, and one of the other characters reacts to it and says, "Oh my gosh, look at the size of that thing. What, are you crazy? You don't need something that big. It's not refined at all." And the Japanese line was something like, "So you're saying that my Zanpakuto is larger than other Soul Reapers, and that's out of the ordinary?" But the flap was a fifth of that. It was just bucka, 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 bucka. That was it.
Wow.
And they usually would want all the terminology put in. But even if you didn't put in Zanpakuto, which is a mouthful, there were still plenty of other words, and I only had a small window. And I stared at it, and I stared at it, and I drummed my fingers on the table. And eventually it just became, "So you're saying I have a big one, huh?" And they kept it. I couldn't believe they kept it, but they kept it.
Well, I think that made up for not coming up with a paper joke earlier.
Thanks. It worked. It kept the spirit and the attitude. And, you know, you try as best you can. I haven't even adapted an episode of anime in 2 years, although I've probably adapted 250 of them. You try as much as you can to mirror precisely the meaning and the feeling of it, but sometimes it becomes impossible, and so you just do your best to honor the spirit of it when you can't.
Because it has to fit the flaps at the end of the day.
And you get sort of hog-tied sometimes, or your hands tied behind your back.
Yeah. So what's been your favorite project to write for? Or a flip side, what's been the most difficult to write for?
Oh, I'm not going to answer that question.
Oh.
I've enjoyed, there are two things I would think of. I've enjoyed writing for the show Naruto, which is a huge bananas anime series that's like Harry Potter, except turn everybody into ninjas. Right. It's great. It is so good. And I've read all the manga for it. I was much more involved several years back. I'm more into the video game space now, but I wrote, I don't know, 50 or 60 episodes on it, and I just became very connected to all the characters, not just my character.
And you voiced Gaara, who becomes one of the larger characters later in the series.
Well, he was always pretty substantial, but he was a murderous little bastard in the beginning, and then he changes. And I've had no role like that either, by the way. I've played him for a decade. I think it's 9 years, maybe 8 or 9 or 10 years.
Given Naruto, probably.
I think we're in the 400s. I don't know if we're in the 500s, but that's a lot of episodes. So I've never played anything that long. I've never done anything that long. But I just really have a lot of friends and in the production, and Mary Elizabeth McGlynn, who's an amazing woman who acts and directs, and you should have her in sometimes. She's one of my favorite people.
We'd love to.
I'll drop a hint. but it just has meant a lot to me over the years. The other thing is Resident Evil 6. I didn't write the plot, just like I didn't write the plot of Naruto. But again, with localization being such a tricky thing, scripts came in, and they had a translator look at it, and they were pretty happy with it. But I was happy that they let me go through and rework not so much the cutscenes, but just the in-game. I really wanted to treat the in-game scripts, just like we did on the Last of Us. The Naughty Dog doesn't treat in-game with their cutscenes any differently. It's just a complete tapestry and goes and goes and goes.
Which is good for the flow of the game.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I feel that I probably improved that connection in 6. I felt like I had an impact on the game because of it.
Well, good. I'm finding a new question.
Sure.
Switching to voice acting, again, you have a huge, huge roster, and your Wikipedia page says something along the lines of, and he usually plays characters who are evil or insane.
That's true.
That's so true. I have to ask, heroes or villains, which do you prefer to play?
I really don't even have a choice in the matter. I tend to get cast as villains. Not always. I don't know. Maybe I'm just a weasel. I've thought about this, not too hard, but I've thought about why this is. And I think that growing up, I was a doofus. I mean, I'm still, but I was bullied a little bit, and I wasn't really great with sports, and I wasn't that confident. I'm still not sure how I flip-flopped and do what I do now, but as a kid, I didn't have a ton of confidence until I started working with words, really, in language, and I got into high school, and I started doing something called forensics, which is not criminal
done
stuff,
forensics,
but
yeah.
Forensics, okay.
Yeah.
So that's where it all started, really, before even plays was forensics, just talking in public. I did prose and poetry. What did you do?
I think it was prose and poetry. It was the shorter book section.
Mm-hmm.
Short stories, essentially, but yeah.
I was trying to remember the original question, and I just did. So a lot of my personality still, like, I still feel like it's in my bones, is that I never felt like I was a leader or a hero. When I was growing up, I gravitated to Gollum. In the animated movie that came out when we were little, or maybe even before we were born. I can't remember when that came out. And the books, and Tetsuo in the movie Akira, and like those kind of characters, downtrodden characters, I felt akin to, even though I wasn't going to destroy Tokyo. And that's just stayed a part of like the fabric of Liam. All this time, so it just happens. It's a little easier for me to do, I think. Or maybe I enjoy it more. Or maybe
A little more range in there than in Heroes?
Maybe I'm trying... That might be true as well. Maybe I'm trying to get revenge vicariously on all the people who put me in lockers. I don't know. I don't really know. I have played Heroes. I've played Soldiers. I've played...
True.
I've played big guys who do good things, and that is also perplexing to me as well. But I've just learned to... take my frontal lobe out and embrace it.
Playing big guys is perplexing?
Yes. I mean, you're talking to me now, right? Do I sound mm-hmm. like one of the horsemen of the apocalypse? This is my voice right now. This is my main voice. And I got hired to play Illidan, who is the massive demon from Warcraft. I've played the Shah of Violence, War, Caius Ballad from the Final Fantasy games. There are all these big, deep, sonorous characters, and so that's something I've stumbled into.
And we had you on Robots in Disguise for Underbite.
Right, and he's huge. He's like a bicep-kissing monster truck, basically. I don't know. And, you know, that wasn't what it was like at the beginning of my career either, because I was cast more true to type for the first 4 or 5 years. The very first job I got was like this little skeevy little sort of stalker kid. And
that's your true to type?
Well, no, but I mean, like, he was, you know, he didn't fit in. He was an outcast.
Makes sense.
So that was my in, I guess. I did a lot of that on stage, too, parts I played. But just, I think what happened is, I might be running on too much of the mouth here.
Oh, no, please, this is fascinating.
I think what happened was I was specifically working at one company, working on an anime earlier in my time in L.A., and someone, as often happens, you play the part you're cast as, and then they say, "Yeah, we got this other guy. He's carrying boxes. You've got 5 lines." And they said, "Yeah, we got this trucker. He's only got like 7 lines, but here it is." And they're like, "Can you do deep?" And I was like, "I don't know." And I pitched it down. And I'm like, "Hey, how's it going? Come on." I don't know what it was exactly, but at that company, they take sound files for everything you do and make like a library. And then mm-hmm. that company hired me for another deep character and another deep character, and then someone else hired me for a deep character, and then just went ping, 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 ping. And before I know it, I was Illidan Stormreach.
And they really like that trucker, I guess.
Yeah, 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 yeah. I do too.
So let's talk a little bit about Illidan, because when I let some of my friends know I was interviewing you, that was their knee-jerk reaction. Oh my God, he's Illidan! Mm. So what's it like playing a boss? Video game boss, I should specify.
A video game boss. That was one that I didn't know where it was going to go. I didn't really have an idea of what Warcraft, what its reach and how passionate its fandom is. And it was, I started on the trailer. I wasn't the first person to do the voice. I replaced. I've replaced people, and I've been replaced. It's just the nature of the business.
Yeah.
And they just had me do, like, they played a voice sample for me, and I did, like, 10 lines from the Burning Crusade trailer. And, like, that turned into a calling card for me. I had no idea that it would, but anytime I go to conventions, people yell the words "You are not prepared" at me, and it was all because of this one trailer I did in a small little box somewhere in Glendale, maybe. I think that's where it was.
Glendale, Burbank, Bang Zoom.
Wasn't Bang Zoom. I think it was someplace that doesn't exist anymore.
There's a lot of those.
Fun fact: every other building in Los Angeles is a recording studio.
Really?
It's about every other building.
Statistically?
Statistically, yes. I have been called in for jobs, and I'll walk up to a door, and I'll look two down. I'll arrive, never having been there, and I'll look over and go, oh, I've been in there 50 times acting. And this is also a recording studio. Is that one? I mean, it's really, like, everywhere. Everybody's got one in their living room here, in the back of their car. I think you might have a recording studio in the back of your recording studio, just to let you know.
Yeah. We are soundproofed, so okay. Could be. Mm. Well, the industry's pretty crazy here. So, you do have the question, what line do fans ask you to quote most often? But I'm guessing that's not prepared.
You are not prepared. That's the number one.
So, what have been some of your favorite fan interactions? What have fans said and done that really stick out in your mind?
I've loved seeing... I'm going to go blank here while I think about it. I've loved seeing kids dress as all the characters from Naruto over time. Gaara wears this big gourd on the back. It looks like a giant peanut.
Yeah.
And I've just gotten a kick out of going to conventions as far as New Zealand and having some, like, 10-year-old or 8-year-old kid come up and go, oh, I love Gaara. He's so cool. And they'll have the big peanut on their back. And it's just so funny.
It's become a game of find the peanut at conventions.
Find the peanut, uh-huh. I get a lot of nice letters. I've gotten, and I'm jumping out of voiceover for a bit, sort of. But
go
with,
for it.
With the show, I play Dungeons & Dragons a lot, recreationally. And this year, that has turned into a show with a bunch of other voice actors on Geek & Sundry. And in a space of about 3 months, a fandom as potent as anything with any other project I've been on sprang up. Overnight. And we get photos and fan art and letters from people who are playing the game for the first time in their lives because they watch us dork around with each other, and imagine that we're in a far-off place. And one of the things we'd hope for is coming true, and that is that tons of people are playing the game. And we've gotten some beautiful letters.
Well, that's
about
great.
It, yeah.
It's come a long way since the negative stigma of, what, the 80s?
Yeah. Yeah, it is. It's kind of going through. It's becoming chic in a way.
All right.
A little bit.
Well, let's talk a little bit about Critical Role.
Yeah.
How did you get into that? How did that get started?
That started back on Resident Evil 6, sort of. I knew Matt Mercer, another great actor. Dungeon Master extraordinaire. He's our DM on the show. And he created the show. Like, it spilled out of his noggin. But I got to know him, directing him as the character Leon Kennedy on Resident Evil 6. And we got along. And about every other time he came in, he'd be like, yeah, I just, I play D&D sometimes with a group of people. Would you want to, excuse me, that was a coffee burp. would you want to come join us? And I really, it sounded great to me, but I was very heavy in with the directing, and there would be meetings late at night, and I had two newish kids. And I didn't have a lot of free time, and I said, maybe someday, one-off. I'll come in for a one-off. I couldn't do it regularly. I just couldn't do it. Fast forward to 3 years ago, and on my birthday, I got it in my head to just do it as a one-time thing with friends. Another side note, I do a podcast called All Work, No Play with Sam Riegel, which is just us being idiots. And we pick something new to do every time, or we try to. And it was the very beginning of the show, and it was just an experiment. I'd say, all right, I'm going to ask seven of our closest friends to play the game as a one-off as a birthday present to me. And we did, and it stuck. And it was amazing to me because I fell in love with it immediately. Like, I'm way more into it now than I was when I was in high school. And it's nerdy on the surface. I guess it's nerdy on the inside and the outside. But but we have a lot of variety in our group. We've got a guy who looks like Colossus playing this game with us. And I feel like that might not have happened 15 years ago, 20 years ago. But we've got some of the most charming, lovely, entertaining people I know in this business. And it just became this thing for us. Even before the show, we didn't play it as much. We played like every 6 weeks, but we all jonesed for it. We were all looked forward to it, and it slowly became real in the back of our heads.
So it started off as a campaign for fun, and then it became a thing with Geek and Sundry?
It started off as it was supposed to just be one night for beers and laughs. Laura Bailey, a great, great, amazing actress, was there, and she, in 5 seconds, dropped into character, started talking like she was a badass elf, half-elf, sorry. I mean, we're all good at improvising and obviously getting into character, and everyone just embraced it wholeheartedly. And it was just something we were doing for fun. And then couple of years into it, Matt at one of our games just said, hey, by the way, and apparently Felicia Day and Geek and Sundry called him in for a meeting and suggested, we'd love to do something with you. We're not sure how to do it or what it would be. And that began like a year-ish of them talking, and every once in a while he'd fill us in. And just when I thought, like, I guess that's not going to happen, then we started.
So that sounds fantastic.
It makes me... I can't even quantify how happy it makes me. It is the space that I am the most carefree in.
Well, good. It should be if you're having fun with a game.
It's a game, yeah.
So what is your favorite aspect of your character?
Oh, on Critical Role?
Yes.
There's various ways to play D&D or to go about doing it. There's some people who play it and are very number crunchy and try to find the weapons that have the highest stat values and the best armor, and I'm going to come up with a spell that will magically farm gold and I'll be rich. And
Rules lawyers.
And I'm not going to say I don't get excited when I find some interesting thing, but I get like tweets from fans, messages from fans saying, you should totally get this or get that, or like, it's so not why I'm into the game. Into the game to do things that I wouldn't necessarily do in life, so I like running into dangerous situations with him. And I know that I'll die eventually. I know it's inevitable. And I don't care.
So you like to kick down the door, then?
Yeah, I do. Well, I mean, half the time, I like doing things that are risky. On purpose. I have grabbed ropes and jumped off of high places. I have gone running into trap-laden rooms without being a good rogue and sussing the situation out. But it's why I'm doing it.
That sounds like an absolute blast. And that's half the fun of D&D, is doing ridiculous stuff.
Yeah.
So is there anything about your character that you want the fans to know that hasn't come up in game yet?
Yeah, I have a couple of secrets that I'm holding on to. I've had some ideas recently that I'm going to slowly start dropping in, but I don't want to say them here.
So we'll just have to wait.
Yes, yeah.
And hope that you survive long enough to tell us what it is you're thinking of.
Character-driven stuff.
All right. Mm. And what's your favorite moment in the campaign so far?
So far?
What really sticks out?
It's impossible to pick one. The one that we talked about the most was shortly before we turned into a show, which was Ashley Johnson from The Last of Us and many other things. She plays a gnome cleric, and she died. We got her back. We were close to a big city, which meant we had access to the holiest of priests, and... But we still had to do this long... Matt made us do this long procedure and roll multiple times. And if we had rolled too crappy enough times, then it would have gone south. But when he told her she was dead, like, we were all... A couple of people were crying.
Oh.
I was close. So that was pretty big. And then we got her back. I mean, it was just... it's stupid how much it affected us.
That's the sign of a really good story.
Or perfect. I also liked, during the show, we were deep in the caverns of the Underdark, which is the underground area of the world, for people who don't know D&D. And we were in some sort of an enemy camp run by these things called mind flayers, which are basically squid-looking dudes who can control your mind.
Land Cthulhu.
Land Cthulhu, yep. And we wanted to get in and take one of them out, so Sam Riegel, who plays a gnome, Bard, and I snuck in, both invisible, I think, and I had the idea for Scanlan to get a bucket of poop. Well, I think I said tar or pitch, and what he found was goblin shit. Oh, sorry.
As you do, I guess.
As you do. Well, there were goblins around. So we had a bucket of stagnant goblin poo, and we snuck in, and I remember being just like vibrating with nervousness because we were surrounded by bad things, walking quietly amongst them, and we just kept rolling okay, and we were rolling okay, and we got there, and Sam's... his bard went invisible and went right into the thing's face, and I did what rogues do, which is I stabbed from behind, and I got him within a millimeter of being finished, and then he tried to hurt me, and then on my next turn, finished him.
Nice.
And I know it's not real, but we none of us want to lose our characters either, yeah, because we've been so invested, and so I knew that I was, again, doing what I said, which is I'm doing something really, some would say stupid, but I would say gutsy, and... pushing it to the limit and seeing if I can make it out.
And it's a sense of accomplishment when your character comes out on top in a campaign.
Yes. If you don't risk it, then you're never going to have those moments. Now, someday I'm going to stick my hand in and I'm going to get it bitten off.
But you're going to lose a hand.
For the time being, yeah. Or a foot, which almost happened. But I will probably keep doing that until I die, and then some other interesting fellow will join the group.
And come up with a new character and just mm-hmm. keep rolling?
Yeah. I played another game for funsies. About a month ago, and even though I knew it was probably a one-off, maybe we'll play it a little bit more on the side, but I instantly fell in love with him too. I was like, oh, I want to do this more, and he's got that, and he's got this, and I can do that. Huh. So it's slowly sinking its claws deeper and deeper into me.
It sounds like it, but that's not a bad thing.
I don't think so.
All right, so getting back to all work, no play.
Yeah.
How did that start?
That came from Sam and I, who Sam is another Swiss Army knife. He acts, he writes, he directs a ton for Disney and Nickelodeon and everybody these days. And but we're really close friends. He's like a brother for me. Love him with all my heart. And we just realized we weren't seeing each other that much. And so we thought, all right, we deluded ourselves and said we'll get together once a week. Which became two, which became a month, which became, we haven't done one in 6 months. We're doing one tonight.
That was actually my next question. I had a couple of fans of the podcast saying, ask them if there's going to be more episodes in the future. We want to know.
They will. They will be totally irregular, and whenever we happen to have free time. The problem is, when we started it, we were in a sweet spot for time because Sam had just had his first child. But when you have a kid, in the beginning, they're like a potato, so they're pretty manageable for the most part. And we're recording it at his place anyway, so he had enough time, and my kids had just gotten old enough that I was able to justify getting out of the house to go and have a crack a beer and talk about stupid stuff. Now he's got two kids, And
they're not potatoes?
They're not potatoes anymore. One of them is just coming out of potato, and one's been out of potato for a while. And he's probably directing more than he ever has in his life, so he has become much more locked up, and I've become slightly more free. So we just haven't had time in the schedule. But that was the whole point of the podcast, which is we work so much. We never do anything fun. We don't see each other. So we're going to force ourselves to get together and have fun and try something new. We did, we played the D&D game. We played multiplayer online for the first time ever, the both of us, which seems simple to most of the people watching this, I'm sure.
What game?
Resident Evil 6.
Nice. Of course.
Ran into walls the whole time. We did... What's the thing on the ice with the broom? What's it called?
Curling.
Curling. We went curling.
You went curling.
We went curling
in L.A.
In L.A., there was a rink. We went curling.
Nice.
Stuff like that. And then we went to a tarot card reader. Yep.
Nice.
Yeah.
So if you don't mind giving us a little preview, what's on the for tonight's episode?
Oh, there isn't one. We rarely know what we're going to talk about. I think we'll try to remember. I don't in this second remember what the last thing we did months ago. There was something. Maybe it was the curling. I think it was the curling.
You ended on curling.
I think it was the curling. So we'll discuss curling and try to come up with something to do between tonight and the next time. And then we'll talk about, I have no idea. Whatever falls out of my butt in the moment.
So there's no real plan going forward. It's just, we did a thing. Let's talk about it.
Yeah. We talk about, when we were regular, it would be, how's your day? How's your week? What have you been working on without giving specifics? We said we could.
NDAs.
War stories. We would share war stories. I think we said in an early episode. And then have a period where we talk about anything. And then we get to the end where we would talk about what we did the last time and what we're going to do the next time. It's all just an excuse to jaw.
So is there anything on your all work, no play bucket list? Anything you'd like to do and then talk about?
I think we want to go rock climbing with Jen Hale sometime.
Nice.
I'd love to go to Burning Man sometime, but that's pretty big. That's a tall order. I don't know if that's going to happen. That's on the bucket list.
That's like actual bucket list.
But it's at the very top of the bucket list. I don't know. I'd like to...
Just stuff and things.
Stuff and
things. And stuff.
Uh-huh.
It sounds like a good thing to do for a podcast. I would like to switch over to Robots in Disguise.
Okay.
Because I am super biased.
Mm-hmm.
Have you been a Transformers fan for a long time, or was this entirely new to you?
Oh, yeah. I watched all of Generation 1. Loved it.
All several hundred episodes, or however many there were?
Well, hundreds of them, yeah. I don't know if I saw every episode, but I watched it constantly. Had plenty of the toys. Went through a period where, I wish I hadn't, but I went through a period where I would take them and get a little screwdriver and try to take them apart and put them back together again. Sometimes successful, sometimes not. Loved the movie. Had my soul and heart crushed when Prime died. And even on the ship, when there was a moment early in that movie. I mean, that movie came out when I was pretty innocent and wide-eyed, but there was a moment at the beginning of that movie.
And it was super traumatic.
Yeah. And the Decepticons raided some sort of Autobot ship, and they implied that they kill everyone on the ship.
Yeah.
They only showed one thing, though, at the end. Ratchet, who's a pretty big character on the show, comes crawling up to him, like, gut shot on the ground, and looks up at Megatron and says, "You know you can't." And Megatron just looks down at him. And Deadpan says, "How heroic." And I was probably 8 or something going, and my innocence was lost.
I don't think anyone expects that going into that movie.
Mm.
I mean, I watched it for the first time about a year ago and went, okay, I knew Optimus died, but the rest of this is like,
time?
What?
The very, very first time?
It came out before I was born.
Well, okay.
I have an excuse. Mm-hmm. So you've been in Transformers for a long time.
Yeah. I used to love going to my best friend when I was a kid. His name is Adam Drucker. He's now a rapper named Dose One. He's great. And his father, Steve Drucker, was Cool Dad. He was the coolest dad and took me and Adam to Forbidden Planet comics in New York City and Chinatown, and we would go and see. And he had all these robots from Japan before. I mean, there was Transformers, and that was it. But they had all these things. I didn't even know what they were. I still don't know what they all were. And just slowly became obsessed with them growing up. Loved Transformers for a long time. And I got to do a couple characters for the Cybertron games several years back. So I got my first taste of it.
War on, Fall of, etc.
Yes, yeah. I played.
Who did you voice?
I played Air Raid for one, and there was a moment in that session where I had to yell, "Optimus, look out!" And it took me 8 times to do it because I kept giggling, kept laughing, because I couldn't believe I was really doing it, because it was such a huge part of my childhood, and I would get like 2/3 of the way through, "Optimus." I'm sorry. This is the one. Optimus, look, I am a Transformer.
childhood dreams come true.
Childhood dreams come true. That's what this career has been, is slowly childhood dream after childhood dream coming true.
And now you've got Underbite on Robots in Disguise.
Yeah, yes, which trumped the games. I'm sorry, I love the games, but to be a part of the sort of lineage of animated series connected to Transformers was huge, 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 huge.
So did you audition specifically for Underbite, or were you picked for that role? How did that process go?
I auditioned for two or three roles. I auditioned for Underbite. I auditioned for... I don't know all the good guys' names by heart. It's going to get me into
jazz,
so much trouble.
Drift.
No, not Jazz, not Drift, guys? Not Fix It, not Bumblebee. Sideswipe? Not Strong Arm. Sideswipe.
You auditioned for Sideswipe.
Red car.
Yeah.
Yes, Sideswipe. Sorry.
Anime
sorry,
hair.
Everybody.
That guy.
And I even scratched an episode or two in the beginning just because.
Really?
Well, just because he wasn't available right away, so I was there.
True.
I think they knew they wanted to use me somehow after the auditions I did, and that's just where I fell in.
So instead of being a speedster, they put you as the big deep voice.
The big deep voice, right. Continuing that chain.
So I have to ask, bots or cons? Autobots or Decepticons?
Oh, Decepticons. Easy. There's no question. No pause. No pause. I mean, it's like my mother always said growing up, Liam, might makes right. Just grab power any way you can. Crush the little guy.
And
take
if you
what you
can
want.
Eat a city along the way,
if
hey.
If you can eat a city, right. If you can... Oh, yeah, that's the dream is... what's his name? Unicron.
Oh, my gosh, really?
Yeah. Yeah, maybe when I get old and I just let it all go and I'm just soaked in whiskey and my voice is, you know, craggly, I can walk in and I can sit down in a chair and talk about eating the world. That'd be all right.
That's wonderful, and I would love to hear that. So what inspired Underbite's voice? Where did you pull that voice from?
What they said in the beginning was that they wanted a wrestler feel. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I have a bit of a twang with what I'm doing, but that wasn't, like, the request. That was just where my mind went when they said big, beefy wrestler brain dude who's in love with himself, in love with his muscles. And then I just pushed as far down on my chest as I'm able. And I think they wanted a big personality, so I'm really doing my best, in addition to chewing cities, to chew scenery for him.
So he's a very ostentatious sort of character.
Yeah. He's got a big personality, so he needs big cities, a lot of room.
So just in general, with all the acting that you've done, if you could redo or redub any role, what would it be and why?
No one has ever asked me that question.
Really?
To redo a role and how would I feel?
Yeah, get a second chance at something.
Who? You're going to make me stall out.
You're just happy with everything you've done?
No, definitely not, but... I also don't want to step on anybody's toes or knock anything. And also, nothing is coming into my head.
Well, obviously, you're perfect.
No. I'd be the first to tell you that I am not perfect. I don't know. My accents are better now than they were at the beginning, so I'm sure I would love to go back and revisit with years of experience to roles I've done back when.
What have been some of the more difficult roles to voice, to get into character, to find the voice, any aspect?
Well, Gollum is difficult, although I love it so much, I don't mind. And that was also just physically taxing. I didn't just do the voice for that game. I performance captured it. So
really?
Yeah, I got the monkey suit on, the spandex, and I climbed all over the place. I mean, it's fun to do. But to do it for 6 or 7 hours, I mean, I'm not 19 anymore. Yeah, I was. There was one scene, his last scene in the game, where he comes skittering down a hill and he just sort of lashes out at other characters in the game. And I did that. They set up boxes, and I'm not a spider, but I basically, sorry.
It's hard.
I basically crawled down like this. Like it was a downward slope, and I went head first and
wow.
Then had to jump around and get physical, and we did that like 8 times. And
wow.
I am not a spring chicken. So I loved it. And in the moment, full of adrenaline and anger and loss and longing, it was great. But then they would yell cut, and I'd go, oh, so that was a huge challenge. Other job that comes to mind is a game called Asura's Wrath, where I played Asura. Mm-hmm. And he was wrathful. He was a sort of
you don't say.
A Japanese deity, and he was just full of anger. And he was just bellowing the entire time. I got to the studio that day, and it was a studio where they had this huge projector screen for the clients to see when they sit on the couch and look up, and they can see in the booth. And it's Excel documents. For video games, we deal primarily in Excel documents all day. I never knew how much Excel would be a part of my life.
Huh.
But we walked in, and I looked at the screen, and it just said in parentheses, in all these rows, Excel rows, scream, 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 scream.
Oh,
and
no.
I said, oh, hey, just want to check. I see the screams up there. That's probably, like, that's the combat stuff. So can we do all, like, his cutscene stuff first, and we'll do the combat later just to preserve my voice? And I went, yeah, that's the cutscenes. So just across the board, he does that 40% of the game, maybe. So they were good to me. They spaced it out. I did short sessions with a week off in between. If they had asked me to do full 4 hours, which is the norm, and then come back the next day and the next day, I would not have been able to do it. I had to do it and then recuperate and do it again and recuperate.
Short sessions and a lot of hot tea.
A lot of hot tea. A lot of something called Ninjam Pepakwa, which is this...
I've never heard of that.
It has slowly taken the voice acting community in LA by storm. It's this Chinese goop that tastes like a really powerful cough syrup, and it coats your throat and sort of coasts you to the end of rougher sessions. We've got all these little habits we have that didn't exist 10 years ago, because 10 years ago, we did not have 100 first-person shooters and Call of Duty games up the wazoo. So every guy, and now women as well, more and more, are going in for sessions to yell, cover me! He's on me! Get over here! I need ammo! And you're going down this long list. So
I'm hit.
And the actor is hit. They're hit. So we have learned, you have to be very careful with your schedule. You have to know, all right, this is probably going to be a rough session. I can't take the job promoting PBS the next day. You're probably going to, if you don't lose your voice, which you're not necessarily, I don't usually lose my voice. It's happened a couple of times. But you are going to sound huskier. I got a job once because I went and yelled like a soldier, and then I auditioned for sort of like a New Orleans jazz band leader, and they liked the texture that I had for my audition, and I booked it because of that.
So you had to blow out your voice for this part.
No, I faked it. Well, that's what got it for me, and then I faked it later.
So what are some other tricks of the trade, then, to help preserve your voice, to help you keep going?
A lot of water, tea, sleep, if you're doing that kind of stuff. Like,
who sleeps?
Who sleeps? Exactly. But if... There have been weeks in my career where I've had 3 or 4 sessions like that scheduled, and
wow.
you can't skimp on sleep. You have to take care of yourself, because if you don't, you're gonna, you know, you'll just get the flu or something afterwards. And know your limits. And also, I've passed on jobs sometimes. Not like I'm done with doing this, but I just know that I got to go in for a commercial or something more subdued, and I have to. That job was here first, and I can't, you know,
makes
knowingly
sense.
Accept a job the day before or 2 days before where I'm yelling about space aliens.
Makes sense. Now, there have been some infamous voice actor stories, like Dragon Ball Z actors passing out in the booth and just things kind of going wrong. Has any of that ever happened to you?
Gone wrong for me.
Just interesting booth stories.
I get hiccups sometimes.
Really?
I get hiccups when I have to do maniacal laughter often.
Really?
Yeah. So I'll go like, and I can't, and we'll have to leave it and come back to it.
And well, you play villains.
I know. It happens like every third time I have to do that. What else? A story I've told before. And it's in a book about voice acting by Yuri Lowenthal and Tara Platt. But the first job, my first voiceover job ever, was on an anime series called Boogie Pop Phantom.
Yes.
And I was in the booth, and something I'm very familiar with now, but I wasn't on day one, is sometimes the Japanese animators will animate a long line or monologue, and it just keeps going. And there's no stopping or pausing, but the human body doesn't work like that. You have to stop and inhale, so you can keep going, but it goes and goes and goes and goes and goes. And you can like try to take a quick catch breath and continue. And so I had this huge monologue where the character's just walking along crazily on the street talking to himself, and I just had to keep going. And I went, okay, here we go. This will probably be like 5 or 6 takes to get this one. And I just started doing it, doing it, doing it, doing it. And somewhere in the middle, I went, and I made it to the end. And a second or two went by, and I had already started processing, okay, on the next take, what am I going to do? Maybe I could try to do the pause there. And then suddenly, boom, a hand slapped up on the glass right next to me, and there was a Post-it between the hand and the glass, and there was an F and a B on it. And I flew back off the stool I was sitting on, and the guy who was on the other side was like, looked rabid. He was like... at the glass, and I thought I was getting fired. I thought I'd said something wrong or insulted Japan, or I didn't know what I had done. And like a beat, and they went, fucking brilliant! So there's that.
And now we know what FB means.
FB. For that, one guy, it means Facebook. Effing brilliant.
That's pretty amazing. So is that one of the more difficult things you've done for voice acting then, just that monologue?
No. That seems easy compared to the shouting for Asura's Wrath or Golluming or Gaara could be taxing sometimes as well.
Screaming and fighting. Mm-hmm. And yeah.
Not so much now. He's very relaxed and groovy, but he used to roid out and turn into a big giant cookie dough monster.
I remember that, mm-hmm. actually. Mm-hmm. So I know it's kind of like picking children, but who's been your favorite to voice?
I'll do five. My five favorites today. Gollum. Gaara. Nightcrawler.
Well, you've got three, and that's pretty good.
We'll stop there. Yeah,
we'll stop there. Your top three.
Mm-hmm.
And what did you like about each of them?
Well, Gollum, I was in love with since a kid. I've read mm-hmm. all those books at least 3 times each. Loved him in that cartoon from when we were younger. And just love the, I wouldn't want to live my life like this every day, but feel, and Gaara is the same. So they share this sort of like they're alone and Gollum much more extreme than Gaara even, but, just the allowing myself to put myself through the raw intensity of being so hated and so, feeling so terrible about yourself, it's cathartic afterwards because I come out of it afterwards and go, I'm not that. I'm not there. I've gone in there and sort of had a taste of it. And you can rage and spit and cry and then come out of it. And it helps. I don't want to get too flowery here, but it helps me to sort of process and cope the smaller by comparison struggles that I have, my life is not all sunshine and lollipops. I have plenty of personal things, just like everybody does.
Yeah,
and it's like screaming in your car in traffic.
And everyone who lives in LA knows how that goes.
Right. But then Nightcrawler is a hero, and he's not full of rage and hate, and he has a German accent, and he teleports and has a prehensile tail, and he was my favorite X-Man?
Mutant?
My favorite mutant growing up. That's how I'm going to say it from now on. He was my favorite mutant in the comics growing up, so that was another childhood dream checked off.
And what franchise did you voice him in? What iteration of X-Men?
I started voicing him in Wolverine and the X-Men, mm-hmm. that cartoon. I also voiced Angel on that. And then there have been a couple other places where I've popped in. What was the last? The last one, I've been in Marvel Heroes, which is the multiplayer online one. I've been doing him.
Nice.
There.
So are there any upcoming projects that you can tell us about? Anything that you're working on that isn't covered by 18,000 NDAs?
No.
No?
No, there isn't.
Just another episode.
Critical
of
Role. Tune in to Critical Role, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be back up next week.
And All Work No Play tonight at some point.
Tonight and then sometime in the future.
Awesome. Hmm. Well, where can the people go if they would like to find out more? Social networks, websites, etc.
You can find me on Facebook. There's a Liam O'Brien page. I'm very active, though, on Twitter, at Voice of O'Brien, O'Brien with an E, like Conan's. And tune into Critical Role on Geek and Sundry. You'll see some of the some of your favorite actors in this universe having a great time.
All right. And thank you so much for coming in today. I had a great time talking with you.
Me too. My pleasure. Thank you.
Of course. As always, you guys, I'm Katie Cullen. You can find me on Twitter, Tumblr, and Instagram at Kiaxet. That's K-I-A-X-E-T. And we will be coming back with Robots in Disguise on Sunday. So until then, thanks for watching.
Roll out.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Oh, look at that.
The views expressed herein are those of the host only. They do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.